This is your last chance. After this, there is no turning back. You take the blue pod, the story ends. You wake up in your bed and believe whatever you want to. You take the red pod, you stay in Wonderland. And I show you how deep the rabbit hole goes. Remember, all I'm offering you, viewer, is the truth. Nothing more. I'm Trilogy, and we're the ghouls next door. And on today's episode, we are starting a new series.
Yeah.
It is called
What?
Mind F. It's about...
Are you confused? So are we.
I can't see anything. I hope we're recording. This is our trippy, we don't know what's real, we don't know what we're doing or what we would do in those situations, and it's scary series.
Yeah, it's kind of like, either possibility could be real. Which is worse? Both? I don't know. Yeah. What are we? Who are we? Do we even exist?
Does real world suck? Yeah. Fake world suck? Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's all that.
What is reality? It's not even, reality is just collective hallucinations.
Yeah, it's just whatever we'll say about. It is, I guess.
You know.
Well, if you hadn't guessed, if you're listening and not viewing us, we are talking about The Matrix.
Yeah.
And simulated realities.
Mm-hmm. Not my biggest fear. I have many fears, friends. But it's the one that started it all in terms of, like, me being young and being like, it'd be cool if this wasn't real. I want this to be a simulation. Let's wake up, give me the pill, or go somewhere else.
Yeah.
So. But also, believed The Matrix was very real for an embarrassingly amount of time of life.
And yes.
Yeah.
I think, we'll get into it. And it's gonna be a time, I think. This whole series is quite the time.
That's why it's called What?
So join us as we figure out what is going on.
Yeah. Come down the rabbit hole.
Facts.
All right, y'all. So stay with me here.
Okay.
What are the chances that we have been living in a simulated reality this whole time?
Pretty likely, honestly.
Yeah. Did you read?
That's just a hypothesis I have.
Oh, nice, nice, cool.
But I'm ready to hear why my opinion is correct.
You read my thoughts? All right, cool. I don't even need to say, except it's not for
no,
you.
No, that's, it's yeah, for it's for everybody else.
It's for everybody else. To answer, as Gabe said, it's very likely. That we are. And it's a fun reason why. That's just, like, really uncomfortable for everyone included. But yeah, if we were, how would this really affect us? Would we be upset? What are the thoughts around it? I ultimately argue.
Yeah.
It doesn't really matter.
Yeah. I mean, what difference does it make?
Yeah. It's our version of real.
Yeah.
It's real to us.
Yeah.
And what I think is that we don't exist outside of this reality. We're brains in a box. You unplug it. There's no, like, secret society that you go out to and defend the human race against an army of machines. It's like, nah, you don't have a body. There's no body.
You're just done.
You just don't exist anymore.
Yeah.
Your conception of your body is just a bunch of signals in your brain saying you have parts. So,
yes. Like,
you maybe don't.
What? Have parts? Wait, what?
Yeah, so I'll explain.
I'm ready.
Yes. So, I think the biggest thing is that if you think this isn't a possibility, you're wrong. Scientists and philosophers actually research this in a big way. And it's pretty realistic that there's a possibility that we could be in a simulation. And it's funny because I was, like, doing a lot of research around this, and I'm not a scientist. just for everyone. That's important, yeah. This is a disclaimer.
Yes.
But I'd read stuff that made me think this was real.
Yeah.
So the idea is that if there is a simulation of, like, our existence, that it's supposedly controlled by a post-human civilization, be that aliens, robots, whatever. It's like something more evolved than us.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a lot of like schools of thought around this, philosophy, science alike, where the idea is, so yeah, it essentially can't be proven or unproven.
Mm-hmm.
Like there's no way to feasibly find out.
Yeah.
So like,
but there's also no way to prove that it's not real.
Exactly. So, in terms of, like, statistics.
Yeah.
Could it happen? 50-50 chance. Because you can't say yes or no.
Yeah.
And there's, like, I was reading, like, all the reasons that people think this is a thing versus all the ones that don't think this is a thing. And all of them were like, it's dumb. We can't prove it, so why? Just, like, it doesn't exist. And then all the ones who, it was just really dumb the whole time. And yeah. All the ones who were, like, they had, like, reasons and science, and also it's just like based on like all these factors, it's like there's no way to prove we're not, and it's also very likely that we are if we're saying that like something post-human is creating simulations of the like upbringing of their society.
Mm-hmm.
That it would be likely that we would be in a simulation. There's also there's a big philosopher, I don't know if he's, like, big physically. I mean, big in terms of big time.
All right. Bold.
You know. Philosopher that argues that there are, like, three possibilities. One that we're...
Wait, what's the philosopher's name?
You know...
Sorry.
Here's his name. I have his picture, paper up. I had that alcohol messed me up.
Bostrom?
Yeah. Nick Bostrom is a philosopher who argues basically three or four things. He says, one, the human species is very likely to go extinct before reaching a post-human stage. Two, any post-human civilization is extremely unlikely to run a significant number of simulations of their evolutionary history or variations thereof. Three, we are almost certainly living in a computer simulation. It follows that the belief that there is a significant chance that we will one day become post-humans who run ancestor simulation is false unless we are currently living in a simulation. So it's like, if it's possible, it's happening, but if it's not, then it's not.
Yeah,
is ultimately that's true. The argument, and you can't prove either, so here we are.
Yeah.
There's other reasons that this makes sense, though. So, in my research, you have the whole idea where it's like, what I was saying is that we obviously have our brains in a box. Like, mm-hmm. The only way we know that we exist is from the signals in our brain, kind of like electro shooting little signals around. And that's how we process our reality. Mm-hmm. So, there is a TED Talk that I watch.
Therefore I am.
Exactly. Gabe, you know what's up. You know. So there's a TED Talk I watched called Your Brain Hallucinates Your Conscious Reality by Anil Seth. So in his TED Talk, he basically runs through how our brain perceives our environment and argues that we are constantly fluctuating between a state of controlled and uncontrolled hallucinations. So if you...
Hallucinations.
Yeah, you got what I'm saying. Hallucinations.
In cool things, we have fun. Tastes like whiskey, smells like whiskey. I don't know what else I expected.
That are motivated by our perceptions of, like, the rules that are designed by our brain. So mm-hmm. It's like, he's ultimately arguing that instead of outward coming in, deciding what we see and how we are and what we are doing, mm-hmm. It's more in going out. Okay. So the rules that we decide in our brain as kind of like best guesses for how stuff's supposed to work, define how we perceive what's in front of us. So if we have no way to process, because we've never seen an example of it previously,
mm-hmm.
Something that's in front of us, we may not even see that thing.
Yeah.
So for example, when I first got Animal Crossing, and they were talking really fast. I didn't know that that's what it was, and I was like, what are they saying? Like, yeah, I can read what they're saying. But, like, I didn't really at first register that they were just talking very quickly. And then you said that they were talking very quickly, and then now I understand what they say when they talk to me.
Marvelous.
Mm-hmm. Because before, my brain didn't have the understanding that that could be a thing.
Mm-hmm.
And then once presented with the reality that it could be a thing, my brain now processed the dialect different.
Yeah.
So basically, our brain looks for what rules govern
mm-hmm.
the earth, society, whatever, uses those as best guess answers to the things that we see every day going forward. So in his TED Talk, he actually has this like cool presentation where he does the same thing as the Animal Crossing analogy I just gave. So he plays audio really like warped and like wonky, I guess, mm-hmm. and no one understood what it was saying.
Yeah.
And then he played the real audio clip for everybody and then did the same thing again and you heard it.
Yeah.
Instantly.
Well, it's like on those like ghost shows where they like have like that weird just like sounds that they recorded, but then they'll mm-hmm. put subtitles and it's like, get out of my house. But it's like they're really it's just like
exactly. But like now like, we hear it.
Oh my gosh, they're the saying distorted else.
Yeah. So that's how our brain perceives our environment around us. So if we have like these preconceived notions, like a brain is not able to actually see what's happening. So it has to kind of go based on the rules that we've given it or yeah. like our conscious mind has given it. So he goes on to say, there is no light or sound inside a skull. All you got to go on is a stream of electrical impulses, which are only indirectly related to things in the world, whatever they may be. So perception, figuring out what is there, has to be a process of informed guesswork in which the brain combines these sensory signals with its prior expectation or beliefs about the way the world is to form its best guess of what caused those signals. So the world sees as much, what the world sees is much more from the inside out instead of the outside in. And he also goes on to say that, like, whatever a collective hallucination is what reality is for the most of society.
Yeah.
So that's how we, like, decide colors and what's normal and
mm-hmm.
all that stuff. Because if some, the most people look at green and say, that's green.
Yeah. We're like, then yeah.
Everyone thinks that's green. Where, you know, the whole dress thing?
Yeah.
With the two different dresses? It's like whatever you have associated with that color, that's the one you're going to see now. And that's how your brain perceives things. And it's all a lie. Yeah. Is what I'm saying. So this is why I think we could have our brain in a box.
Yeah.
If our brain has never seen anything and it's being fed the idea of what the world is, we have no reason to question that if we don't have the actual reality of eyes.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, yeah. With the whole, as you were saying, in life, outside of the ghouls when we record, the whole, my eyes hurt because you've never seen before.
Yeah.
Did I ruin it?
No, we'll talk about it again.
Nice. It's fine. So basically, you know, if you've never actually, we could be in a box because if we've never actually existed.
Seen outside of the box.
The box is the world.
Yeah.
Whatever's being fed to our brains is what our perception of reality yeah. is.
And it doesn't make it any less the world. Exactly. It still is the world.
Exactly.
Even if it's the box.
You literally just said my next thought.
I'm sorry.
I love
say
you
it now.
So much.
Okay.
You're so great.
Okay, good.
Okay. So when I say this,
I'm
that
not
is
sorry.
So if we're, like, thinking that we're in this, if we're thinking that we're in a simulation, is that, like, less than? So, like, people who are like, we need to get out.
Red pill, rabbit hole, other what, analogies.
What I'm arguing is that there is no out.
Okay.
There's no, like, tubes that pop out of our body, and then we slide down this wonderful water
slide.
Into nothingness, and then the big...
And then they...
Robot machine.
Learn your muscles how to move.
Taught us how, like, they got him on the first try. Absolutely not with that claw machine. That's not yes. how it works. So you have to, like, you get him by his one finger, pull
yeah.
him up slowly.
Break his arm.
Exactly. But he doesn't know because he never used his arm before. He's, like, atrophied
you
all over.
You can't use it, yeah. I watched Kill Bill.
That's
what happened to her.
So, yeah, if we're arguing that, like, within the simulation, whatever governs that simulation, we are not in charge of it. So, like, yeah. consequences still exist.
Yeah.
Your life, as it is governed entirely by whatever the laws of the simulation are. Mm-hmm. So, like, if you think you're going to get out of it by dying, I think it's very unlikely that that is a thing. Because if you're going to drive your car off a bridge, and gravity is something that is governing this realm, you deciding gravity isn't real will not make your car not fall off that bridge when you drive off of it. Your car is gone now, and you are not out of the simulation.
The spoon is still a spoon.
Yes. You did not, you have no control over the realm. Yes, it's on your brain, but someone is sending those signals to your brain.
Yeah.
You did not send the signals.
That's why you die in the game, you die in real life.
Exactly. So, if you're in a simulation, the whole thing is, like, dying is not the way out.
Yeah.
Like, that is not the route.
Yes.
Because...
you're not going to wake up.
Yeah. So, if there's, like, a thing that's sending signals and its understanding of when you end the simulation because you have died in the game...
Mm-hmm.
There's, you're dead in real life. So it's, there is no real life. There's nothing. Yeah. Like, you are just gone. I'm sorry. But, like, you're not getting out of the simulation. There's no pills.
No.
And, yeah, it's just all, like, a matter of perception. So it's, like, we kind of just got to make this simulation the best simulation life that we can live.
Yeah.
Live your best simulation life.
Yeah.
You got to do it. There's no other route. Sorry.
Yeah. And, like, all those people who are like, if this is what the simulation is, like, it's rude because it made my life hard and all this stuff. It's like, it had to do that so that we would believe it.
Exactly.
Like, we can't have Pleasantville.
Yeah, because then it feels wrong.
Yeah.
And we want to get out.
We as human are flawed, so we only believe in a flawed existence.
Yeah. And I would argue, because of that, like, even the crappiest things...
Yeah.
So it's like that's why.
That's what makes us real.
Exactly. And I, as someone who feels very uncomfortable with inauthentic emotions and
like dolls.
Acting or like, yeah. I get real upset. I don't know. I would get real uncomfortable in a pleasant, I would also try to escape if it was Pleasantville. I'd be like, I don't even want to know.
Yeah.
Good is the.
Yeah.
I need struggle. I need pain. I need to feel alive.
Yeah.
Drive off the bridge, but no. I survive it.
No.
Anything to feel alive. Just kidding. I don't know. But yeah, this is the only situation that we're in. Even if we're in a simulation, it don't matter.
Yeah.
We're here, like, this is what reality is.
Yeah.
Collective hallucination. You're welcome.
So we watched stuff, and if you didn't know, we watched the trilogy of Matrix.
Yeah.
Which is what I get my cool name from. My Matrix name was Trilogy.
Favorite movie as a child, other than Terminator 2.
Yeah.
Terminator 2 lasted up into adulthood. Yeah. Matrix lasted until, like...
until you stop leaving.
Yeah, honestly.
You never stop leaving in the Terminator, that's true.
Mm-hmm.
For our viewers and listeners, this was my first time watching it. So that was fun, watching all of them, actually. I know what it's about, and I knew the clips, and I knew the stuff. So I just know, it just never came up.
I think you just need to up your sci-fi life. Game. I think that's more so it.
Like, I definitely have been out of it. I just, like, robots and, like,
I feel the like future sci-fi,
tech, all that. I was just like... I don't need it. But I enjoyed it. It was fine. I had a fun time. So the first film of Matrix was in 1999. It is directed by the Wachowski sisters, Lana and Lily. So the first one is, a computer hacker learns from mysterious rebels about the true nature of his reality and his role in the war against its controllers. And then there was a second one.
There is. Reloaded. Neo and his allies race against time before the machines discover the city Zion and destroy it. While seeking the truth about the Matrix, Neo must save Trinity from a dark fate within his dreams.
Yes. And then you're left with a to be continued at the end of a movie. Wild.
Yeah, both from 2003. Just, they made this, they just kept filming.
Yeah, yeah. It just was two movies worth of content. Yeah. So then we also got Revolutions, also 2003. The human city of Zion defends itself against the massive invasions of machines as Neo fights to end the war at another front, while also opposing the rogue agent Smith.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's what happened.
It did. We watched it the whole time.
Yeah, everyone knows, everyone knows what The Matrix is about. And, like, I part of me was, like, reluctant to do this episode because I was like, this is stuff everybody already heard. Like, you can't really get that deep, but I'm just going to put my own spin on what this film does. I think we'll revisit some of this when we do a later episode about really cool filming techniques because there's some really notable, like, historic things that happened with filming The Matrix and also, like, stunt-related and, like, just... with all of that, that we'll talk to someone who's, like, super knowledgeable in that. Mm-hmm. So I won't be geeking out about film techniques. So if that's what you're looking for, I'm sorry.
It will happen.
Yeah.
In a...
Yes, later.
Different simulation.
Instead, this will be geared towards, like, what we're supposed to be learning from The Matrix. And I just want everyone to just have a seat, right? Because we are about to have some fun in the way that the ghouls do. Mm-hmm. Because The Matrix is very much relevant right now to what is happening. Like, it's so many years ago that this was made, and now I'm like, this is so relevant right now. I wish people understood, like, what themes are and motifs and symbolism.
Now we're gonna.
Yeah, so we're gonna dive into some current issues and the main theme behind Matrix, which I found to be the oppression of our capitalistic society.
Nice.
Yeah. I can't wait for, like, the comments when they're like, not everything is capitalism or the patriarchy.
But it is,
stop being
though.
A liberal crazy person. Like, it is, though.
But it is, though.
But it is. But you better put on your glasses because it's going down. So there won't be so much, like, there's spoilers in that. Like, the whole thing is that he's in the Matrix. So yes. That's the big spoiler that everyone knows.
It's also from 1999. The first initial spoiler is 1999.
Watching it as someone who's super late to the game, when we were watching it at the beginning, I was like, and I was telling Kat, I was like, this is such a good horror movie because just imagine, like, that time period. Like, I mean, I'm, like, being super, like,
young. Imagine me go back in time.
Imagine me go back to, I'm being, like, young person right now. Like, Gen Zs where they're like, what's a VHS player? And you're like, oh. That's kind of how I felt, but, like, I'm just imagining, like, being back in time, watching this for the first time, not knowing, like, what it's about, and just seeing this, like, dude who gets this message on his computer, and it's, like, you can tell from the computer that this is very new technology, right? Like, it's so, like, it's such a, big idea to grasp, and he's got, like, his little floppy disks, and then he's, like, just told on this phone that, like, he needs to trust this and that they're coming for him. And it's just like, this crazy, like, you're like, what? And then, like, as soon as we, like, leave the Matrix, then it was, like, kind of hokey and fun. But I was like, that whole first part, I was like, this is scary. This is terrifying.
Yes.
And, like,
how it all unfolds. So many nightmares of mine.
I believe it. I totally believe it. And so I kind of felt cheated as someone who, like, society has spoiled with, like, the, reality of what it was.
Oh, yeah, the spoilers
of
it.
I wish I could have, like, been blocked. Like, I wish I could have been Neo waking up in the Matrix, watching the Matrix. You know, like, why do my eyes hurt? So, the big thing that that the Matrix is based off of is the Procession of Simulacra, which is by, or the, it's actually not called that. It is called... Simulacra and Simulation is what it's called, and it's by Jean Baudrillard, French.
Baudrillard?
Yes.
Baudrillard?
Baudrillard. I don't know. With French sounds. And the reason why this is, the more prolific thing to refer to is that, like, Neo literally stashes his illegal software in a hollowed-out copy of this book. Mm-hmm. So they're like, look it, this is what it's from. So this was published in 1981, and it essentially argues that consumer culture is our simulated world because it relies on us, like, replaying and imitating reality in what, like, we don't really need anymore. So, like, we have we live in a very easy society in life, right? Yeah. So, like, we do fitness not because we might die tomorrow because there's animals chasing us and we have to survive and we have to catch those things. It's because we want to be fit and we want to be hot. Like, it's for these purely just, like, superficial reasons. Because
our doctor tells us that our heart hurts and yeah, that we should do it.
Because you've just been sitting there. But, I mean, like, it's very, like, minimal in regards to, like, how we used to have to survive, right? Yeah. Like, a lot of the ways, like, we're just kind of playing human in a way now.
Where you're playing the game of being human.
Yeah, exactly. So there's even, like, a line in the film where Morpheus introduced Neo when he brings him to the real world. He says... he calls it the desert of the real, which is a phrase taken from the first page of the simulacra and simulation. And so that's, like, one of the main things is, like, they're saying we have this, like, simulation. Like, we have been told this is what reality is, and now we're just kind of playing. Like, we're playing people.
Yeah.
So we don't need the things that we need, we used to need. And so, like, that's kind of, like, where we get that. And that's where... like, capitalism is a machine, right? Like, you're, like, we don't need any of the things in the simulation, but they're designed that way because we perceive that we do need those things.
Yeah.
Right? The entire concept of Matrix films can be interpreted as a criticism of the unreal consumer culture that we live in. And I got these quotes from SparkNotes.
Ooh, super well, that's helpful. Cool.
Yeah. There were some other, like, things. There was, like, a ad for a article that was like top 10 thirstiest characters in novels, and I was like, gonna click it. It was bad. I think it should be done better because it wasn't correct. But anyway, that's where I got a lot of this information from, if you're wondering. But essentially, in this consumer culture, that it distracts us from the reality that we are being exploited by someone or something, just as the machines exploit the humans in the Matrix for bioelectricity, right? Mm-hmm. So it's like, we're going through the motions of being a human and being a person so that we can fit into the society's box that tells us this is what society is, and we don't ask any questions about our reality. We're not like, but what if this isn't real? And so, yeah. And in one of the quotes in there is that the consumer society is premised on the idea that consumption is a powerful element of social control, whereby desires long attached from material needs are instilled as a part of system of signs and subsequent satisfied via another system of signs. So it's, like I said, you don't need it, but we think we need it.
Yeah.
And so we do those things. So, we have this, like, which is going to lead me to my big, my next big rant. Essentially, there's this quote from Morpheus and Neo where they're talking about what the Matrix is. And Morpheus says, "The Matrix is everywhere. It is all around us. Even now in this very room. You can see it when you look out your window or when you turn on your television. You can feel it when you go to work, when you go to church, when you pay your taxes. It is a world that has been pulled over your eyes to blind you from the truth." And Neo says, "What truth?" And so he says, "That you are a slave. Like everyone else, you were born into bondage, born into a prison that you cannot taste, smell, or touch, a prison for your own mind." Oof. Which brings me to my main man, Karl Marx, y'all. Yeah. So,
yeah, that's pretty real.
Woo-hoo, let's talk about him. I'm excited. When I was like kind of going down this, I was like, that sounds like... we are slaves to capitalism. And then I saw one line that said it. I was like, here we go. Dive. And now I'm going down to my rabbit hole, which is Karl Marx. And me and him were good pals. So essentially, we are currently living in a simulation nightmare, right? Because capitalism is so strongly ingrained in us that even now, when we exist in a literal pandemic nightmare, that highlights all of the flaws in our, like, society and system, like, a lot of things clearly were not working. Mm-hmm. We are still fighting against that to go back to normal, quote-unquote.
Normal is bad.
Right? Like, we have this society that we have these severely underpaid and underappreciated workers who previously to this pandemic, we said were not good enough or qualified enough to earn $15 an hour, but now they're essential. Mm-hmm. Right? And we want everyone to go back to work so we can have Karen and Chad and all of them get their hair cut and they can go to the movies. Because that's important to us in our society. It's not. It's not important. It is not a necessity to survive. You know what a necessity to survive is? Health. Being not sick. So that's where we're at.
Having enough money to pay rent. Having to have enough, like, house.
Yeah.
Or to feel safe and maybe not...
Maybe don't have to pay rent. Let's freeze rent. Ridiculous. Anyway, I got into... I started a Facebook argument today where someone had posted, like, that 72% of Americans believe that we need to keep America closed, essentially, until it is safe, until the health officials say it's safe. And someone commented on this person's post and said, it is your right to go outside, or your right to stay inside, just like it's my right to go outside. And then, like, and you can practice that. And then the person who posted it commented, like, I don't have the right to go to stay inside, because she's an essential employee.
Yeah.
And I commented, if they open it up, they are expecting everyone to go out now. If you want the economy to be fixed, they are expecting you to go out. So if you do not go out, it is a choice, and now all those things that were protecting us are gone. Like, they won't have those things in place for you. So it takes away your choice that you thought you had to go in or out. So it's not real. None of this is real. We're in a simulation. So we have, you know, these, you know, people who are protesting to reopen our economy, for their haircuts, which is ridiculous, right?
And then they're all getting sick, like, and being like, oh, dang, maybe
I wish more of them got sick, honestly.
Wrong.
Yeah, like, it's for these really useless, unimportant things, but they are seen as important because of the simulation that we live in, right? It mm-hmm. is like this acting out of humanity that we have put so much importance on these mundane things that don't really exist. Like, we really need to just take a break and be people and whatever. So it's like, for all those people, kindly take a seat, Boomer. I don't want it. You're not out here. I mean, honestly, the very existence of our current president and the honest likelihood of the next 4 years being him as well, just because of the state of the world, and it's really tragic and sad. It makes me really sad. Really shows us how far this fantasy and simulation goes.
Yeah.
Right? Because we have a fantasy in America, which we've discussed in previous episodes, and it's called the American Dream. Mm-hmm. Right? It's the American simulation, right? And so it's this incredibly fictional and unattainable dream that keeps our society in check, just like Karl Marx said, right? We have this, like, we, his counterpart, what is his name? Oh, I'm so rude. Engels, yes, Engels. He essentially calls it this false consciousness. So there's mm-hmm. this idea that we don't know that we're being controlled or that we don't have any power because we perceive ourselves to not be controlled and not mm-hmm. have any power. We believe that we are above that and we're not, you know, in the simulation, but you are. Yeah, we live this American dream because, and we talked about this before, that we don't want to change the world because we want to benefit and, like, reap the benefits later.
Yeah.
When we achieve the dream, right?
That we won't achieve.
And it just makes me think of Cypher in the film, who is, spoilers, the bad guy, right? He's the one who is out there in the Matrix, and he has this time where he looks and he's just like, I don't want to struggle anymore. I don't want to live this awful life. I want to go back. The simulation. And I was like, dog, I get it. Like, I'm with you. Like, I don't want to, like, put everybody else under the bus, but I can understand. And, like, being an American and understanding how Americans think, I was like, 100% people would go back. We all want to think that we're the heroes that would, like, fight back against it and revolutionize, but we don't do that.
A lot of people want the easy way out.
We do not do that. It's very apparent. We are living in, like, the worst timeline right now with the way that people are reacting. So very clearly that, like, we wouldn't have the revolution that they have in the film, unfortunately. But with Cypher, he has this moment where he's with Agent Smith and he's eating a steak. And he says, I know the steak isn't real.
Yeah.
I know it's fake and you're just putting stuff in my mind, but when I take a bite, it's delicious and I want this. And he is willing to give up everything and to put his friends, quote unquote, in danger because he wants the money and the luxury, no matter how fake it is, even though he knows that is an illusion, he wants to live the illusion.
Yeah.
And that's America. It's the American dream is you want to live that illusion, right?
He wants all of it. You think it'll bring you happiness and it's...
Yeah. Yeah. And it's like, does this sound familiar? Right? And it does. Yeah. Because we, in our current life, in horror of society, right, we don't have giant insect-like Lovecraftian robots siphoning our bodies for energy. Honestly, that couldn't happen. We don't have enough energy in us to fuel enough. Yeah. It's dumb. But we do have real monsters that are the money-hungry corporations and billionaires. I'm looking at you, Jeff Bezos, who could pay for all the unemployment that's happening in this country right now and not even notice. Like, wouldn't even notice. It would do nothing. He has too much money. He couldn't even spend it in this lifetime. That should be illegal. Anyway, I'm looking at the, like, those are the things that are siphoning the actual, like, energy from us. Because we go to work, we put in all that time and effort, not getting $15 an hour. And then at the end of it, you end up dead and he ends up a millionaire with money he does not need. He is the robot. Like, that's, wake up, sheeple, is where yeah. I'm at right now, right?
Well, yeah, people are essential until they're not. Like, that's yeah. essential. Like, they weren't essential before.
Yeah.
We
and
thought
now, all of a sudden.
They just weren't educated. They didn't work hard enough to get up higher in the ranks.
Yeah.
But now they're essential because the virus can kill everybody.
Yeah. It doesn't care. It doesn't discriminate. It doesn't know what essential and non-essential is. It doesn't know what a college degree is.
So what we want back is convenience.
Mm-hmm.
So we're telling them that they're essential because, yes, I mean, the basic needs that we need are food, water.
Yeah.
Health care, stuff like that. So
yeah. Like, you know, making sure things
but
are
But we
clean.
Don't want to actually give those people the things that they deserve to survive and feel okay.
Because
mm-hmm. we hope to be Jeff Bezos one day.
Yeah. And it's like that those robots and the monsters in this film are essentially that 1%, right? Those are mm-hmm. the people who are, you know, living off of our hard work, our energy, our literal energy. Like, they are the robots siphoning our energy, and we're doing that. Like, and we are in the matrix in that we live in this capitalistic society where we are distracted by means and goods, right? We're distracted by the internet, by TikTok, right? Like,
yeah.
we're in this, like, happy-go-lucky world where we need, and it's not to hate on, like, finding those outlets, because this world is really dark and it's totally okay for you to find those outlets.
Yeah.
But it's more of an understanding that, like, we can't use that to also continue to be blind to the problems in our society that have been shown to be the problems, right? Like, we have
yeah.
highlighted them now that we can look at them clearly. We can all take a step back and go, that wasn't working. Everything's falling apart. What makes you think that if we just do it all over again the same way? It's like you keep doing the same thing over and over and expecting different results. That's stupidity. That is idiocy. That's not real.
Insanity.
Yes, it's insanity. And so we have to take that to and understand that we are the cogs in the machine. Like, whether or not we really are, like, if this is all a simulation, right?
Yeah.
Our simulation is designed to make the people work for the few, and those few are the robots that are siphoning our energy, right? And we do this every day, and we do it willingly because we're blind, right? And because it's convenient to not look and not to ask questions and not to create a problem, right?
Yeah.
It's convenient to use Amazon's two-day shipping, especially now, to get something that you really do not need during the quarantine. No one's seeing you, right?
Yeah.
And, like, but people are doing that, and people are actively putting other people in harm's way because of this simulation that we've lived in for forever. So that's why I was like,
yeah.
It just seems so, like, you know, apparent, right? And so Marx argues that the working class is exploited by the ruling class, and the working class exploitation is only possible because it does not perceive itself as being exploited. Like, we just are too proud to admit that this is a problem. And so it misunderstands its own position because it's distracted by all of those things that we've been playing at, like
yeah.
the simulacra, right? And so then we, you know, don't try to change it. Right, so
mm-hmm.
there's other parts where, so Morpheus says that the Matrix is a system. He says that system is our enemy, but when you're inside, what do you see? Businessmen, teachers, lawyers, carpenters, the very minds of the people we are trying to save. But until we do, these people are part of that system, and that makes them our enemy. Because at the end of the day, people are going to go back into the simulation.
Yeah.
They're not going to rise up and try to make a difference. And sometimes you gotta sacrifice those people in order to get there. It was, like, their way to validate hurting the real people, which I was like, when I was watching, I was like, oh God, that's a real person. Yeah, they're like killing all those real people, and it was freaking me out. But like, I get it, because it's like they're unfortunately a means to an end. And if the higher ups are willing to use us as tools, we kind of have to look past it as well and sink to their level. There's other themes in this that I'll kind of go over pretty briefly. There is this play with fate and free will, and my argument for this is that free will isn't real. It doesn't exist. And the reason for that is the placement of the oracle, which they try to, like, fix up at the end in the trilogy, the last one, where she said, like, she didn't really know. She was just believing and guessing. But her belief in her position of power is what influenced that. It's like, would they have done any of those things? Would this ending happen if she didn't? So she was effectively creating that world. It's kind of that thing. It's like, did I choose this or am I, you know, like if you hear about fate, hear about what your fate is, and it happens, is it because it was going to happen anyway or is it because someone told you?
Yeah, so and then like the people who try to avoid it or whatever, like they've changed.
Yeah, and then you're like, but you still end up, like, it's a whole thing.
If you thought you were going to die, would you still go on that trip? And it's like,
And then it's like with her, is like she told him that he wasn't the chosen one because then he would act. Like she was purposely manipulating him to get the results she wanted.
Yeah, and she says it very early on because he knocks over the lamp. She says, don't worry about the lamp. He turns to say, what lamp? Yeah. Knocks over the lamp. And he's like, the real question is, would you have knocked it over if I didn't say anything?
Exactly.
And that's like, what'll mess with you.
Yeah, and like, don't even get me started with the whole motifs of the magical Negroes that we have in this film. We have two of them. And in the original casting, Neo was supposed to be Will Smith. And then Morpheus was a white actor, which I'm blanking on who it was, which would have been a nice, refreshing thing. Like, old white man tells young black boy how to be the one. I would love that film. Let's remake it. Because as much as I love Lawrence Fishburne, I thought he did a really amazing job, it gets tiring. And I know it's the 90s, it's fine.
It was 1999. Yes. Things were still very offensive. And they still are now, Wachowskis, but like even more.
They did an amazing job with, like, you know, the diversity of characters. There was something I was reading about trans inclusion and the different kind of roles that were happening, and the character Switch was actually supposed to be androgynous, and more so that they were supposed to fluidly change between being male and female. Like, they would have a male actor and a female actor playing this character that would switch between roles, and that was amazing to me. I thought really that would have been phenomenal. And I mean, they've already done so much at that time, like, given the limited ability that they had. So I give kudos to them, definitely. There's no, like, I mean, it's just the way of the world that we get these characters, right? The last thing I kind of want to touch on is Plato's allegory of the cave. Because, that's what the whole simulation is. And so, like Kat said, there's a time where Neo wakes up in the real world, and he's like, why do my eyes hurt? And Morpheus is like, that's because you've never used them before. And I was like, what in the Plato's allegory of the cave is going on here? I was like, yeah. It's like, that's exactly what it is. So if you don't know what Plato's allegory of the cave is, essentially, Plato, the philosopher, you know him, he imagined this cave in which people have been kept prisoner since birth. This is the only thing they've ever known is this cave. They're bound in a way that they can only see, like, their backs to, like, a wall, and they can only see shadows on the wall. They can't see each other. It's darkness. They can only see shadows. So they perceive reality as these shadows. Things are those shadows. People are those shadows. And voices, right?
Yeah.
One of them gets free. He goes out into the real world, sees that it's a lot. One, it's terrifying and it's crippling because he's never seen the world before. It's blinding, all of this light. But eventually he learns. And so then he goes back to help the prisoners and slowly teach them what the real world is.
Yeah.
And so there's this whole, like, the biggest part of this is that Plato says that those who free themselves and come to perceive reality have a duty to return and teach others, which is what Neo's whole thing is. It's like he wants to release them. Although in the end, the Oracle and the Architect have this agreement that it is a choice.
Yeah.
That people will choose to stay in or leave, but they will be given that choice actively, right? So it's like a part of it is like, not quite, but it is something, right? And he is going back, and he is seen as, like, the one. I won't even go into that because I think it's kind of dumb. but that's kind of, like, the whole role of this film is that when you have come to the truth, it is your job to go through. And that's what Morpheus and the team do.
Mm-hmm.
They go back and they try to save people, and they slowly do, and that's how we have Zion. So
yeah.
There's a lot of religious allegory in here. Nebuchadnezzar has, like, a plaque on it. This is Mark 3, number 11. And in the Gospel of Mark in the New Testament, it says, "And unclean spirits, when they saw him, fell down before him and cried, saying, Thou art the Son of God," which is, like, supposed to be Neo, because he's the chosen one. But one I thought was fun is Agent Smith's first appearance in Matrix Reloaded. We see a license plate that says IS-5416, which is in the Old Testament, chapter 54, verse 16 of Isaiah, and it reads, "Behold, I have created the Smith that bloweth the coals in the fire, and that bringeth forth an instrument for his work, and I have created the waster to destroy." So, and actually, in this chapter, Isaiah refers to the Lord's assurance that Zion, the promised land for the Israelites, will be victorious in future glory. And he reminds his people that he created everything and goes on to reassure them that no weapon forged against you will prevail. So it's so literally like, this is what the film is. Right from the beginning. Don't you love religious allegory? It's one of my favorites. There's a lot in here. Yeah. Like, especially if you go to Spark Notes or you just go to anything about the Matrix, you know, there's things about, like, the reflections or the fact that, like, robots and people, it's kind of hard to distinguish the differences between them, mm-hmm. because the people, when they're in there, are pretty robotic and just follow the rules, and yeah. then the robots are the ones that are doing things weird and at times seem more human. So yeah. it's a very interesting, like, dichotomy there. I think it's just telling you, like, that what we expect robots to be is wrong. That the robots would be us. The robots would look just like us, and if not more like us. And that's how, like, because you wouldn't really believe it otherwise.
Yeah.
Like, you wouldn't trust a robot that's all insect-like and scary and has a baby face. but if a person walks up and is like, "Here's what reality is," you're like, yeah.
And then it's just, honestly, since the humans are the ones that are more robotic inside the simulation, it's just going to show that, like, we are, like, easily, in terms of capitalism, manipulated into following the flow of things so that we do not get cast out
yeah.
from society or whatever the whatever hallucination we think is normal. We yeah. want the collective one to be the one that we see
yeah.
so that we're not considered
yeah.
to have uncontrolled hallucinations and any sort of, like, mental health.
Yes.
Okay, so now
maybe we're more enlightened.
Feeling. Yeah, feelings. Yeah, I said feelings.
Because we're trying to incite the rebellion. If I haven't gotten you now, like, I get you every single time. I try.
Crazy eye things. Crazy.
I try. Okay. So if you like it, it is Rage Against the Machine.
Mm-hmm.
And if you didn't know, the machine is capitalism. Rage yeah. against it. We do not want to go back to normal. We want to change things, right?
Yeah.
And if you don't like it, it is the wrong answer, which is putting things back to normal and to, you know, go back into the simulation willy-nilly and not having learned anything, Cypher.
Yeah, and, you know, when he's in the car and they're like, you know what, where that road goes. You know what's down that we've walked in a million times. And then I was like, I was 7 the first time I watched this. I didn't realize he meant, like, life.
Like, philosophically.
Walking a path that you've walked a million times. If you're just going to do this, you're not going to learn from your mistakes.
If you just keep going, like, just try, like, something new.
I wonder if he lives down there, is what I thought when I was younger.
Sorry, I think it was, like, a little of both, right? So for the topic of the fact that we are living in a simulation.
Like, do I believe it, or I think it's, like, good?
It's good, I don't know.
It's a bad time.
To live in the simulation.
But I don't want to say that we should go back to normal, because I think it would be such a waste of us finally slowing down to realize that us never seeing our families or us never talking to people that we care about because we don't have time is how we should want to live.
Yeah.
I just feel like we shouldn't want to be in the simulation because the simulation is making us just, like, mindlessly trying to get these things that we don't need. Like,
yeah, we're the robots.
What we need is to be able to survive, to feel comfortable, to be around the people that we love, because that's what brings us happiness, and not a ton of money. Like, we need to enjoy ourselves, not just, like, go and go and go until we cannot go anymore, and then just pain, pain, more pain, sad, yeah. More sad, die.
Mm-hmm. And so. I think, like, on the topic of, like, what you said, like, if we do live in an actual, like, if reality is simulated, like, just in real life, right?
Yeah.
I think, whatever, that's fine. That doesn't matter. Like, I don't think, simulation that we should be, like, red-pilling out of, I think the simulation within the simulation, which is capitalism and, like, the way that we're kind of being run and controlled by the higher-ups, that's the red pill, right? And yeah. The red pill is, like, you know, doing protests and speaking out and being the people, like, we are stronger. And Marx said it, right? Like, we got to seize the means of operation. And now is a better time than any, because yeah. The world is in chaos. The whole world is in chaos, and it's very clear that this isn't working.
Yeah, like, if we go back to normal, it's just, it would just be such an insult. Just so gross. Like, half the people who, like, had the excuse that they were so busy that they couldn't do anything or notice. It's like, everything has stopped.
You have no choice now.
You see it. And then if you go back to normal, you're telling everyone, I mean, maybe they will, but you're telling every single person who has been struggling for, like, a very long time that you see it now and you just don't care.
It doesn't matter. Yeah. And you just want to go back to eating that fake steak. You want the fake money. Money is paper. It's not real.
Use your toxic morality and just try to be better. Like, now that you've seen it, I don't even care if you don't want to. Be like, All right, to be a good person is to care. I'm going to pretend that I care.
Yeah.
And do a lot of nice things for people. Because honestly, I used to think intention mattered. Now, impact matters.
Yeah.
So it's like, I don't care if you mean it or not. I don't care if you're trying to be good because you want to be good. No.
Yeah.
Just be better, because everything sucks and we just need people to fake it a little bit, I guess, to fix the problem.
Yeah, we need more medium place people, like from a good place. Or like one girl, she was like awful her life, but she did one really good thing. Like, even if, like, you know, you don't know 100% why you're doing it, do it, because it's what is expected of you to help people. What about for the film?
Oh, I love The Matrix. It was a great time.
Yeah, it was fun. We didn't watch the Animatrix. Much to the sadness of my boyfriend, Mike, he really wanted us to. I think we might in the future.
Yeah, I mean, it's all like, we can.
Look fun.
We're in the simulation for a little while longer, so.
Yeah, but we watch it. We have quite a lot of fun to do this series of What Mind If. It's going to be really trippy, so I hope if you enjoy this. I don't know if all of them will be political.
I don't know if we expected this one to get political.
I didn't know until we're like, it was happening.
Oh, it's crazy. What if, like, simulation was?
Yeah.
Now we're like, okay, it is, though.
Yeah. I think, like, I think it'll just be, like, kind of, like, trippy and, like, what is real and how do you know what you're doing, I guess, is kind of, like, the thing. But if you haven't already and you like this video and you like this topic, please hit subscribe and like to let us know. Leave us a comment on iTunes or wherever you're listening, because it means a lot to us. And
it ultimately means nothing, but it means a lot to us.
Yeah. In this simulation, it means a lot to us. We don't need to survive, but we kind of need to survive. So
we're not getting paid, and we're going to do it anyway, but
it's nice to know you're listening and you're there.
It's nice to know.
So, with that being said, don't get married.
Delete your kids.
Yeah. Or what did I say?
Your kids are a simulation and aren't real.
Yeah.
But you love them anyway because they're your robot babies.
Yeah.
Their hair isn't existing, but it feels real to you as you pat them at night.
Good night,
robot baby.
I love you, robot baby.
Robot baby, you're so great.
Thank you for existing.
Yeah.
Okay, bye.
Bye.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah.